26th of September, 1973. To the Playhouse for just a minute. Both shows were outrageous. Derek Nimmo and me just attacked Parsons till he got all cowed and spluttery, and Amy MacDonald blethered on with me, crying, "Oh, shut your row, you're obviously mad." And Clement Freud said that William the Conqueror defeated Harry with the Wake instead of Harold at Hastings. I had a drink with everyone in the pub, and David Hatch said, yes, it was all appalling, absolute anarchy. It got out of hand, I'm afraid.
So, Kenneth, you have the subject, and there are 34 seconds on how it should be done, starting now.
How it should be done is this. You present the protagonist, the antagonist, and you make a resume. And then you say to people, this is...
What's Amy MacDonald's
charge? Now!
I can't understand what he's just babbling, he's hesitating.
Well, he was trying to go quickly, because he knew that if he didn't go quickly, you would challenge him for going slowly and pausing. So, I'm afraid
no,
he has
there
a...
No, but there is a
happy... Why don't she shut up? Shouldn't have women on the show at all.
No, he keeps us up on this occasion, Amy. Kenneth, you continue on how it should be done. The 29 seconds left, starting now.
The incident... The in... The,
Clement
you ruined me, you put me off. She keeps making faces and behaving ridiculously.
Yes, Amy MacDonald is now getting to know how to play the game. She's making faces at Kenneth Williams and putting him off, the same as he put Amy off before. Clement, what is your challenge?
Either repetition or deviation.
Neither. Kenneth keeps the subject, and there are 26
seconds.
What,
the instant, the instant?
There are 26 seconds, Kenneth, how it should be done, starting now.
How it should be done is the right way. In other words, if somebody has...
Derek Nimmo has challenged.
You said right way before.
Yes, I'm afraid you did, Derek. Kenneth.
Well, there you've been mucking about so much that one wonders what one has said. I think you showed a little more generosity of spirit.
Yes, he should do, but he has the subject now. 14 seconds, how it should be done, starting...
How it should be done is quite simple, really. You bend the lady back across your knee like that, stroke her up and down her thighs, gradually undo her hands and pulling the neck back...
Clement Freud, the challenge! Too far by illustrating with Amy.
Deviation. He hasn't said what he's doing.
October 31st. I went on to do this chat spot with Russell Harty at 8:40. The interview rambled about and weaved from one thing to another in a most inconsequential fashion. The one certain thing you can always feel with an audience is their desire for authority.
You live alone, and you're a private person, which you've just said.
I'm not a gregarious person by nature. I really do like being alone. And I find, anyway, that relationships are such an appalling intrusion on privacy. You see, the falling in love is a terrible sort of loss of privacy, isn't it?
Have you fallen in love ever?
No. I don't think it's possible for someone like me. I'm a complete egotist, you see. And my world revolves about myself. First thing in the morning, I look in the mirror and think, what a dish, I think. All that, you know, this wonderful figure, I mean, you know, and this hair, spun gold, it's been described. I've been described, as you know, a head of spun gold. I hope they're getting it in colour. And I love all that aspect of myself, you know, and I spend hours looking at the body and thinking all this beauty, you know, and I wouldn't want to share it.
One of the researchers on the programme took me to dinner. On the return, I met two boys from Kuwait in the lift and invited myself to their flat. And the good-looking one, Barda, flung me on the bed and made violent love to me. I was saying, "This is madness, Barda, I'm pissed," and I fell off the bed and cut my elbow. 1st of November. On my knees at one point, saying to God, "Oh, I am so ashamed," and begging to be forgiven. 29th of September. Walked to the talk of the town. The house was very thin, with loads of empty tables. They were good-humoured and very nelly. My opening was fair, the second spot fair, and I dried completely at the fourth. Peter had to come on and give me the prompt. When I told the audience, "I've forgotten my lines," they all began to applaud loudly. I stopped them saying, "Never clap incompetence," and then went on.
Good evening, and welcome to another edition of International Cabaret. And may I say what an honour it is for you to have me here tonight, because I have just literally got out of bed. I've been terribly ill. I've had the most appalling flu, which has left me awfully nasal, I'm afraid. It would have to forgive me. I can hardly breathe. No, my nostrils are completely bunged up. I had to do it all through the mouth, and it was making all the larynx dry up, you see. And I said to the producer, "My legs are like jelly. I can hardly walk this week." And he said, "You could hardly walk last week." It was very rude. He said, "If you like, I'll tell you what we could do." He said, "We could have you sitting on a stool. Take the weight off your feet, you know, open it rather casually." sitting on a stool. You know, it'll have a peel. It says banana, but I don't want that either. I said, all these stools are upholstered in PVC. It's ghastly. I mean, it makes all the material stick to you. You know what I mean? I said, it makes the trousers stick to your legs. It makes you want to tear them off. He said, it's not a bad idea for an opening. I said, no, thank you. I said, I'm not exposing my legs in public. Oh, let's face it, they've seen better days. He said, well, if you never take them off, they've never seen any days, have they? I said, no, but quite a few nights, luxuriating on the flannelette sheets. Love, I've got myself going, I can tell you.
Still full of guilt about my behaviour with the audience last night. At one point, I took the trousers down and said, look at the lovely airy legs. And Jenny played for every cheap laugh in the book. It was disgraceful. 3rd of December, 1975. I'm worried about tonight. I've had my own TV show before, and it's not really worked, and this time it's make or break. The show began with a packed house at about 8:10, and it was a nightmare of changes. It was out of one costume and into another all the time, and it seemed like I never stopped talking. The voice got more and more like gravel, and on the last note of the French song, it cracked. The house was a dream. I've always been right to reject all this good luck rubbish from a cast or anyone else. I hate it before a show. It's nothing to do with luck. It's God deciding to give you something. He gave it to me tonight. It was nothing to do with material or acting. He gave me an atmosphere of such love and affection that I couldn't go wrong. Terry Hughes said, I've never done a TV show that's gone so well in every number. And Peter Ead said, you were superb. You were really inspired tonight. I was glad I'd invited no one.
On est soit qui mal y pense, faites-vous jurer qu'on ne sense, Amir Smith palais des danses, badinage ma crepe Suzette, du blanc tendre resteront deux. Jacques Cousteau qui s'en rende, où aille la plume des matantes. C'est la vie, ma crêpe Suzette. Trop sage, massage, frère Jacques. Salon. En avion, pètes-tu la classe? Fiancés ensemble, lorgnette, lingerie de toilette, gauloise cigarette, entourage. Ma crêpe Suzette, citron, mirage, Carvel, eau d'oeuvre, Brut et Chanel, chaise longe, sachet et sel, fuselage, ma crêpe Suzette, pince-nez, bidet, commissionnaire, mon repos, Brigitte Bardot, je sens frontière. It's a knock on you. The French, I mean, non, c'est ça. Oh, pardon, espionnage, gruyère, camembert, fromage, mayonnaise, all night, garage, RSVP, ma crêpe Suzette.
8th of July, 1982. Taxi came and took me to Pebble Mill. I introduced the various items in the Children's Festival and ran from studio to studio acting as a general enthuser for the project. 15 minutes lunch break, and then I was back at it. I was in and out of 6 studios working on one thing or another.
Who's this for?
Tanya.
It's not an easy name to write, Tanya, is it? Because the N occurs right next to the Y and makes an inconvenient conjunction. What are you laughing at? You laugh at it. It's very serious. The whole business of writing is very serious.
How did you learn to talk like that?
How did I learn to talk like that? What do you mean? I mean, I've always talked like this. I had to learn to talk standard English. I mean, my natural talk was Cockney. I mean, I was brought up with Cockney. People, you know, who talk like that all the time. You know, we never said many of our consonants and our vowels got mangled. You know, we said, hey, going out today, going out. We never said it was going out. And I had to learn, when I took up acting seriously, I had to learn to say, are you going out? I had to learn all that. It took me ages. Who's this for?
It's Louise.
Every little breeze seems to whisper. Do you know that number?
Really?
Do you know that number?
No.
Every little breeze seems to whisper. Louise.
12th of April, 1983. In the afternoon, I went to John Lewis for toilet bags and then to Mowbray's for thrillers for The Journey Tomorrow. Started learning the Asp sketch because they want me to do a turn of some sort on the Mike Walsh show in Sydney. Oh, heavens, here I am relearning stuff I performed originally in 1959. Extraordinary how it hasn't dated at all.
I've got a viper in this box, you know.
Really? Good gracious me.
Oh, yes, it's not an Asp.
Oh, good.
Looks rather like one, but it's not one. Oh, no, I wouldn't have an Asp.
No, I suppose not.
Some people can't tell the difference between a viper and an asp. More fool them, I say.
Yes, quite.
Cleopatra had an asp, I haven't.
Yes, well, I'm glad of that.
I don't want one either. No, I'd rather have a viper myself.
Yes, well, that's all right then, isn't it?
But it's not that they're cheaper to run, because if anything, a viper is more voracious than the asp. My viper eats like a horse.
Like a horse, eh?
Yes, I'd like a horse. I could do with a horse. Well, nothing against horses. But mind you, I could never get a horse into a little box like this.
Yes, that would be a bit difficult.
No, no. You couldn't cram a horse into a little box like that. It's not a horse box. A viper, yes, but a horse, no.
7th of June. Today is the start of this awful filming job, Comic Roots. Walked to Cromer Street, we did shots outside the block, and then on to the Duke Street Drill Hall, shots in Woburn Walk and Euston Road and St Pancras Church, and then to the school in Camden Street. Shots in the playground with the children, which I didn't even know they were taking. I was just chatting away to the children. 9th of June. Collected Louis and went to vote for the Conservatives. Then to Lyric Hammersmith, where we did the concluding shot.
It was in this theatre, the Lyric Hammersmith, that I did my first review, which later transferred to the West End. And then years later, I came back to direct my first play, which also transferred. And that means that this auditorium has a lot of affectionate memories for me. And the wheel turned full cycle when the schoolmaster who'd directed The Rose and the Ring all those years ago came backstage to visit me here, and we talked about what decides you on a career. I said then that I thought talent was something you were born with, but that style and the form would change with all the influences that came into your life, all the people you've ever liked. And the way that Shelley puts it, we are a portion of everything we've ever loved. And I think it is those loves that form the tissue, if you like, of belief and faith. Because acting is all about faith. Performing is making an act of faith, believing that you can create reciprocity between the auditorium and the stage. And that's why when the atheist says, what if life's pointless, what if it's all a joke, has to be answered by the comedian. Well, if it is a joke, let's make it a good one.
5th of December, 1984. As I was struggling up Great Portland Street with the shopping, there were endless cries of, hello, Kenny, etc., etc. I thought, I am sick of greetings and good wishes. And I jotted down the results when I got home and stuck them in this diary under the heading, Greetings. It all flowed quite naturally, and I was pleased with the result. I'm tired of all the nods, all the nudges and the winks. I'm tired of all conjecture as to what the public thinks. But I must go on playing at this game of let's pretend, getting precious comfort from the knowledge it must end. And send me to that other place where all the spent ones come, where vanity is silent and all the pop groups dumb. Peace is there in plenty, and there's innocence again, shelter for the good folk and the bad left in the rain. I'm sure there will be justice, though the wicked will not burn. They'll be forced to entertain us with an everlasting turn. Hitler and Napoleon and even Genghis Khan, made to do a tap dance or tell a funny yarn. The audience sitting comfortably, no heckling and no chaff, and the poor benighted beggars getting not a single laugh. 11th of January, 1986. To Devonshire Place to see Ian Murray Lyon. He examined me, said he didn't think there was any need for hospitalisation, sent me to Harley Street for blood test, and is going to arrange barium X-ray next week. Told me to eat bland, mushy food and chew well. He's a very likeable man. At 6 o'clock I took 2 paracetamol and Bisodol, because I don't want to do the show feeling lousy. Car came at 6:15 to take me to TV Centre for the Joan Rivers show.
How nice to meet you.
Thank God it's not PVC I'm sitting on. I can't stand that stuff, and so often you get PVC to sit on, and I have to be very careful, as you probably know. Yes, I've been in 3 times for the operations, you know.
And are you...
On the nether regions.
Okay now?
Not really, no. I suffer very badly from wind. A lot of Bisodol and stuff like that, you know, and it's interfered with my career on more than one occasion. In fact, I remember a love scene with Maggie Smith, and I was kneeling. It was called The Private Ear and the Public Eye. And I was kneeling. My speech to her was, let me be the frog, you know, that turns into the prince. And this inadvertent wind broke. And she said, when she was upstage, she said, front rower, that. And that didn't exactly help me, you know. When I went back afterwards, I said to her in the dressing room, you know, what did you say that for? That would have gone by ordinarily, you know. She says, best to air these things. And the very same thing occurred with Joan Sims in Carry On Up the Khyber. I was the Kazi of Kalibur, I was playing. The Kazi of Kalibur, they call me. And I had to say to her, you are a jewel, my darling, you are a jewel. And then again, I broke wind, and they said, cut, cut, cut. And all the cameras stopped, and the director said, that was heard on the soundtrack. And she rose in great hauteur and said, how can you make love to people blowing off? Oh, it's so disgusting. And they all went right off of it. I said, oh, come off it, for goodness sake. You were none of us perfect. Even Valentino blew off. And she said, yes, but... She said, yes, but they were silent films.
30th of January, 1986. Nothing to eat or drink this morning. At 10 o'clock, they wheeled me down to floor 1 for this gastroscopy. They said I was sedated, but I was conscious throughout. Got a cup of tea at 12:15. A doctor called and said, you've got a big ulcer there. It's smoking that causes it. Must have dropped off for a bit. At about 3:30, they wheeled me down to the ground floor for the scan. Needle in my arm and dye put in there. The nausea rises in the throat. Then an endless series of order. Breathe in, hold it, breathe out, etc. Ad infinitum nauseam. Then wheel back to the 15th floor. Idiot porters asking questions. What's your next job, Ken? And what about another carry-on? One finds a face to meet the face. 22nd of November, 87. I went to Shepherd's Bush to rehearse Wogan with Hugh Paddock. We rehearsed with Wogan perfunctorily, with Terry saying, that's enough, let's keep it fresh. The theatre was full of deadbeats. Irene Handel in a wheelchair. Oh, it was ghastly. The tedium was unbelievable. We got away about 10:45 and Hugh said, don't bother about makeup, let's go. So we got into the car and I was home about 11 o'clock. Went into Lou's flat quietly and took a tin of soup and 2 bits of bread. Had that before going to bed because I'd not eaten properly all day. Heard the clock strike 12 o'clock. Thought of Hugh saying at 3 o'clock, I think this is all going to be a bit hairy. Oh, he was so right.
Hello, I'm Julian. This is my friend Sandy.
Oh, hello. Phone up. Come down, yeah.
Of course, because it's round the horn. I used to listen to it when I was a child. Many's the Sunday lunchtime, I twiddle the old cat's whisker.
Cat's whisker? You're sounding old-fashioned, making it sound old-fashioned, and he bold.
Bold, he's gone too far. We're not that old!
No.
Mind you, we're not in the first flush.
No, he hasn't flushed for years, have you?
No, I like to keep myself to myself.
He's become quite withdrawn, haven't you? Withdrawn.
We haven't heard you on the air for some time.
No.
What have you been doing with yourself?
Well, to tell the truth, we have been rather quiet lately. I mean, after we retired from show business, we decided to go up Portugal.
Portugal, the Algarve, Albufeira. Yes.
Same to you.
And we opened a nice little guest house.
Guest house. Bonalati. Bonalati. As a regular Omi from Omi.
Yes.
Omi from Omi, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. Unfortunately, it fizzled.
Fizzled. Fizzled right out. Fizzled. Mm. Which was a rotten shame, wasn't it? Oh, it was a shame. He put a lot into that, didn't you?
Everything.
Go on, tell him you put a lot into it.
Did.
He put his pension in.
Well, half my pension, or as the French might say, demi-pension.
There he goes again. French, you see. Oh, he's a dab end at the Polari. Oh,
25th of February, 1988. Repaired Lou's switch on her reading lamp on the dressing table. The new switch cost me £1.40, and when Lou asked me what she owed me, I said, well, there's the cost of the switch, then there's the labour costs, then there's a VAT, so call it £28. She said, good night, and we both laughed. The 6th of March. Michael came and took me and Lou to the Paris for just a minute. Both shows were awful. Flew out after and evaded autograph hunters.
Kenneth takes the next round, and the subject is faux pas. Will you tell us something, something I'm sure you've never been guilty of, Kenneth? But will you talk on it starting now?
Well, faux pas is a French expression, faux meaning erroneous, pas as in pace, so a wrong step. We can all make such errors. A lady wrote about me on this program, saying après moi la déluge instead of le. Well, I wrote back and said to her, Dr. Johnson, faced with the same problem apropos the definition of pastern, was asked by an inquirer, how come you got it wrong? And he said, ignorance, ma'am, pure, and then repeated that word. Thing to do when you commit the faux pas is to own up and say, well, yes, all right, I made a mistake, the man who never... No.
11th of March. Stanley came and drove me to Upper Street where we had dinner at a very friendly restaurant. The soup was good, but I couldn't eat the fish. It was too raw. And anyway, the stomach was agony all the time. Pain diminished a bit when I had a glass of wine, but it soon returned. I fear I was awful company. One is bifurcated by pain. The mind keeps wandering off onto another tack. I think this is the worst period I've had since the onset of the trouble in early 86. No, it is worse, because now it is ever-present, night and day, an endless bane. I could hardly take in any of the conversation, but tried to interject appropriately every now and again. 12th of March. Went into Lou to make bed and said, I really didn't want to eat lunch. I feel so awful. Wish I was dead and out of it all. But what about me? Was the reply. Nothing about my welfare, only what about me? 19th of March. After the cornflakes, pain started. When Michael came, I said I couldn't face going out. He was very patient and understanding. He said, you really should see someone else about this endless pain. Eventually I took loads of hot water and Gaviscon. Saw Lou in the evening. Watched the TV, Creatures Great and Small. It was, as usual, superb. Oh, it's the best thing one can see. The pain continued. Returned to the flat about 6:45. Took more K&M and Bicidol. Thought of making an end of it tonight, and then wondered whether things were left in proper order. Should I write a letter to Michael, best of people and best of my friends? Would it be fair to ask him to tell all the others, the dear chums like Stanley and Gordon, Paul? Oh, I don't suppose any of it would matter, once I'm gone. One only hopes that an autopsy would reveal the cause of all the pain, might help somebody else. Oh, to be out of it forever! To cease upon the midnight with no pain. Why do I linger? Not from love of life. I've always found it awful. No, it's rather from a sense of curiosity, not wanting to miss the third act. 21st of March. Kept thinking, I could have gone last night. Need to have been here this morning to face another day of agony. Well, I think everything's been thought of. My will is deposited with the Midland Bank. Michael gets most of the stuff, and I should think he could fix Lou in some retirement home. Dreared through the day. Went to have the hair cut. Seems odd to bother about such things before dying. Had nothing to eat. Coffee at 4 o'clock and took Librax in, but it didn't kill the pain. The sun has come out, as if to say, "Stay, I am beautiful," but I am not deceived. 14th of April. Up at 7 o'clock and got the papers. Back pain still continues to be a bane. Went to collect Lou's watch at the tube. The charge was £4, which was after I'd remonstrated about the £4.95. Thereafter I felt so weak I wanted to flake out. The pain between hunger pangs and rats gnawing at your belly gets worse and worse. Dragged myself round Boots and M&S to do the shopping, home by 11.30. Ate biscuits and the relief was pretty quick, but the exhaustion immense. At 12.30 had fish cakes for lunch on my own in Lou's flat. She's gone to her club and then had a lie down. Oh, I'm so tired these days. No energy at all. Pain came back with a vengeance. Nothing seems to allay it now. Rang Sheila at Murray Lion and rang Agent and rang these video people. Sheila said she'd get on to Reynolds about an operation, and we've said some time after 25th of April. Even if the op don't work, I can't be any worse off than I am at the moment. Had meal with Lou at 5.30. Saw the news, watched the dreary saga of murder and mayhem. By 6.30 the pain in the back was pulsating as it's never done before. So this, plus the stomach trouble, combines to torture me. Oh, what's the bloody point?